right, we got a new guest on the channel today, man. Mr. Colmile Ave, New Braunfels himself. We got Banco up in the building. And I ain't never been a bitch, built different, see a chance, I'm a mug.
And baby took it off like piece by piece. Last man he couldn't do it cause he ain't like me. And I heard y'all little songs but they ain't like these. And I grind all winter and I ball all spring. Yeah, it's Nike double hoodies started for us. They symbolic to this life that I been working for. I got goals that I don't talk about, I'm working towards. And they don't wanna talk about it, baby, check the score. Bad woman, good weed.
What's going on, brother?
Just chilling, man, chilling.
I just wanna say I appreciate you pulling up. I said, we talked about doing this for a while now, so we finally get it to happen, man. So, man, I've been watching you for, like, the past year. How has this artist journey been for you so far?
Fun. It's been fun. It's been, man, it's been crazy. Man, everything and more than, like, I thought it would be, you know? For sure.
It looks like you're working hard, but you're one of the few artists I can say you're actually, like, you're having fun with it. You know what I mean? Like, some people, they're stressed out or complaining, but you, it's kind of like you're working, but you're having fun. Is that true to say?
Yeah, 100%. 100%. I mean, it's stressful for sure. It's a job, you know? It's like, it's a job, but, like, what am I going to do? What am I going to get out complaining about, like, the little stuff, you know? So, like, I try and enjoy, like, somebody told me that when I first started. One of my best friends, G, down from Dios, he told me, he was like, to like embrace the shit, you have to like enjoy even the worst parts, you know, like you have to be positive about the worst parts, because then you won't be able to enjoy the good shit, you know. It's like,
so what are some things about it that you're enjoying, you know, enjoying the most of the whole thing?
Man, seeing people react to like my daily life, because like I rap about like, I rap about normal shit. I was telling my homie that the other day. Like, I feel like I rap about, like, normal things. I just so happen to make it sound cool. That's what I think. Like, I think I make, like, normal shit sound cool. So, because of that, getting people to, like, react to that or, like, the way they like it or, you know, shit like that is, like, so cool to me. It's like, damn, like, y'all, it's resonating with y'all. Like, that's been the coolest thing to me.
You definitely rap about, sounds like rich shit, but you know what I'm saying? Like, you know, like a player lifestyle, your music, you know what I mean? Laid back, feel good, man. Every time you ride and just smooth. It's like a soundtrack to life, basically.
For sure. You know what I mean? Lifestyle shit.
Now, how was it growing up, you know, in New Braunfels?
I grew up like half of my life over here in San Antonio too. So like my parents were separated. So my dad he's from the South Side. So, like, I'd be with my dad a lot, you know. So, I got to see a lot of different things, you know. Like, I didn't get to see San Antonio all the time. But, like, when I did get to grow up here, it was, like, a culture shock compared to, like, growing up in New Braunfels. Because it's not as small as it used to be. But, like, it's just a small city. Like, when I was younger, everybody knew each other. Like, everybody, all the, like, families, even, like, adult-wise. Like, all the families knew each other. Like, everybody knew each other. So, it was, like, it's just, like, one big-ass hood. But it's never been like hood like that or like gangster like that at all. So like it was just, it's weird, man. Growing up in New Braunfels has been weird. So like that's why I can never rap no gangster shit. I'm never gonna rap about like, you know what I mean? Like I don't be sliding on nobody. I don't be, you know, I just be doing like normal shit. So it's been cool, man. Coming from New Braunfels, I wear it with pride now, you know?
Yeah, and it's cool because, you know, most people, they'll rep the bigger city, you know, especially you being from New Braunfels, and there's probably like a stigma that comes with it, like, man, nobody's from Braunfels, what the fuck is out there? Was that a decision? Did you ever decide, you know, that you wanted to rep San Antonio at one point?
Nah, because I have a lot more respect for San Antonio than that. You know, like, just being around here when I was younger, like, I know how it is. Like, I mean, it's tough. You know, it's gritty out here. So, it's like, who would I be, like, being some kid from San Antonio or New Braunfels repping San Antonio? You know, there's, like, somebody coming to New Braunfels from San Marcos and repping New Braunfels. You know, so, like, I couldn't do that. I love San Antonio, though. I love the shit out of San Antonio. But I'm from New Braunfels, man.
Would you say you're not the first, but you're kind of the artist from the Braunfels that kind of is basically like paving the way for everybody else out there?
I hope so. I mean, I hope that's how it looks, I guess. Actually, I don't know how to answer that because I have my OGs. Like, my homie Matthew Jordan, he used to go by Cardi. There's this guy named Andres. He used to go by Real Talk. There was rappers that put me on in New Braunfels. You know, like, it never really, like, blew up out of the city, but, like, they showed me how to do. They showed me everything about music that I knew at that time. And so, I guess, yeah, I'm the first one that's paving the way outside of the city. So, like, I hope that's how it looks, for sure.
Now, what were some, I guess, the differences that you're able to do versus that, you know, they were doing that you're able to kind of get that spotlight put on the city?
My OGs, like, the rappers in New Braunfels that were doing it before me were, like, the first rappers in New Braunfels that had the internet. And so, they were just, like, the first rappers in New Braunfels, really. So, like, I guess they didn't have the experience yet or, like, get to see, like, how to blow up. Whereas, like, other cities had those resources and stuff like that. Because New Braunfels, we don't have a hip-hop community and shit like that. So, like, they were freestyling, no pun intended, but like they were freestyling like how to do it. So I guess now like I have the experience of being able to see what they did and like comparing it to just like other regions in the country and different stuff like that and being able to like, man, it's all research and development really, like from a business standpoint, like, and using the internet, like utilizing that.
So that's a good analogy, good way, you know, the outlook on it.
Yeah, for sure.
Man, I want to jump into River City to Summer, man. That is probably, I know you're gonna have other projects, but I think that's gonna be your Illmatic. You know what I mean? For me personally, because I feel like that project kind of really put a lot of eyes on you, man. A lot of people. Like, how was working on that project?
Man, it was fun. I wrapped it up. Like, honestly, bro, I dropped Ball Out of Control in March last year, right? And then I started working on River City Summer like the week after I dropped. So I went to California the week after I dropped Ball Out of Control. And then I came back and just started recording everything for River City Summer. And it took about like a month and a half to get all the music done. And then after that, it was just all about like wrapping up the little stuff.
Now, what did that project do for you? Like, was it more like opportunities that came with it when you put that project out?
For sure. Mostly because I was like kicking it with Dios and Georgie and Les and G and everybody down in Houston. So like just being their homie, like, and them knowing I was cooking something up, they were like 100% behind it. And then one day Georgie and Les hit me about getting Les on the project. And so getting that feature from Les and putting it on the project definitely did a lot, man. Like, opened up a lot of doors, man. Cause Les is like a legend, bro. Like, he's, you know, so having his audience see me and like having them see him co-sign someone, because he's never done that kind of thing, you know, like he's never taken somebody and like put them under his wing the way he did for me. So like it did a lot for me, bro, like for sure.
One thing I noticed about, you know, the project and your music, it's its own sound. Did you plan on, was that something that you wanted to do for your music?
I don't think so. Because I know exactly what you're saying, because like the sound, I started dropping music because I was trying to hear more music that I wanted to hear, you know, like there's a certain sound that I like to listen to. And so what I wanted to do was make more music like that. And what ended up happening is I feel like I created like a totally different sound. Like, I feel like my beat selection is kind of like the same as like what I like to listen to, like the West Coast rappers I like to listen to. But like my delivery and shit like that is still so Texas that it's like, it's weird. Like, it's something that I'm barely starting to accept, that I'm like, damn, like, it's my own little thing. Like, no one's really, like, got that same sound either. So, yeah, I didn't intend to. I'm glad I did, but, like, I didn't mean to do that.
You know, because hearing that, the project, like, in your music, like, it reminds me of, like, listening to Chronic, how it's just, you know, it's that theme that, you know what I'm saying, all the beats, they flow together.
Yeah.
So, when you hear a Banco record, you know what kind of sound you're going to get. And that's rare for artists to do because they're all over the place. But you kind of have that, your signature sound that you come with, man. That's a good look.
I appreciate that.
How did you end up linking with the producer of the project?
It's a few of them. So all the producers I fuck with, I rock with super heavy. Like Hunger Force produced a lot of those records. He produces a lot of records for me. DJ Idea, 98, Rego, and then Foley. I think those are everybody that was. And there's somebody else on. There's somebody else on River City Summer. I can't think of the name. His name right now. Forgive me. I kind of started rapping over their beats when I first started dropping. And I just established that relationship, like, with them. You know, I kept consistently shopping with them and getting beats from them. That it just established a relationship where they kind of recognized my sound. And now, like, even, like, 98, just clockwork, he sends me a beat pack, like, every month or twice a month. And it's always just, like, a new, refreshing sound. But, man, finding them was just the internet, because none of them are from Texas.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, none of them are from Texas.
Man, that's the power of the internet.
Bro, you could do whatever you want these days, man. The sky's the limit.
You know, the crazy part is you have your team of producers, because, you know, I don't see it happening now, but you go back to the 90s, Biggie and them, he surrounded his team with, you know, yeah, Easy Mo B, yeah, DJ Premier, he had all these guys. You know, Tupac had all these guys. Jay-Z had his set of guys. You know what I mean? And some producers, some artists, you know what I'm saying, it's kind of, but you have a team of, yeah, these are my go-to guys. Yep. That's dope.
Yeah, those are the guys.
That's dope to see. I want to get into something, man. You printed up the CDs.
Yeah.
$50. Mm-hmm. Let's go ahead and just talk about that for a second.
Man, it was just a crazy idea, I guess, I had at the time. Because I was putting the project together, and it was going to be my first project that I ever dropped, you know. And at the time, I was spending so much money on it. I was like, well, how can I recoup and, like, make my money back and then some, you know? And I'm a big fan of Nip, bro, like, and not on no fake fan, like, I didn't start listening to him because he died. Like, that's like any day of the week, bro, you can ask me who my favorite rappers are, it's probably gonna change, but in no particular order, Nip, Dom, Les, and Zero, like, my favorite rappers. And so I learned a lot from Nip, like, just the, like, he raps, bro, and, like, if you're listening to Nip just to listen to him, it's cool, but if you listen to him to learn something, you're gonna learn a lot. And so what he did with Crenshaw was he made 100 or 1,000 copies. I don't know. But he made a limited amount of copies and sold them all for $100. And, like, he started that campaign to show rappers that you could do it independently. You know, like, he did it for himself for sure, but he also did it, like, to show the rap game that you could do that. And so me and my boy Tanish just had this great idea of, like, man, why can't we do it, you know? And so it's crazy that I didn't think I was going to sell one of them, bro. Like, you know, like, and we ended up selling 50 of them for $50. So, $50 a piece.
And, you know, we're in a streaming era. So, of course, you know, nobody's really, especially upcoming artists, there's no money generated from Spotify or Apple.
Yeah.
You find an alternative route.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? That it's possible to make money because, you know what I'm saying? Y'all invest a lot and you'll want to get a return.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
For sure.
That was dope to see, man.
Appreciate that.
That was dope because a lot of people want to do it, but they can't do it. Mm-hmm. You have the foundation to do it, man. So I just want to say congrats on that because you're establishing your own little, your fan base, you know what I mean? Your cult following, and that they're going to support you 100%.
Thank you.
Oh, man. So let's talk about developing your work ethic. You're in 100% artist mode, like, you're doing interviews, you know what I'm saying? You're going from city to city. How did you develop that mind state?
No one else is going to do it for me, you know? Like, if I don't do it, no one else is going to do it for me. And at this point, like, one day, when I dropped, right? So I dropped Keep It P as a single first. And it like, received so much love right away that I told myself, like, well, shit, I can't stop now. And that's been my mind state, like, ever since I dropped, because it's like, well, if I stop, it's gonna be mad embarrassing, because, like, you got this far and you're just gonna quit. So, like, my idea to the work ethic is just, like, I can't stop, you know. It's more so, it's gonna be more embarrassing if I stop than more fulfilling it, you know. Like, I gotta do it because no one else is gonna do it for me. So, you know,
that's good. You're not depending on nobody. It's just, like I said, you got to put the work in.
Not to take away from everybody that helps me, though.
Right. Cause,
like, I mean, it's shout out Shay, you know, shout out my boy Tannis, shout out my producers, shout out my engineers. Like, all I do is rap, bro. Like, I say that, like, that's something I, like, one of my mantras in life is, like, do one thing and do it well, you know? So, like, I know there's a lot of rappers, and not to take away from them, but, like, there's a lot of rappers that, oh, I produce all my own stuff, I engineer all my own stuff, I blah, 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 I do everything on my own, which is cool, like, that's great. I can't do that, personally, because then if I try to engineer something, I'm going to over-engineer, and then I won't be happy with the record, and then it's going to take away from the quality of, like, my raps, or it's going to, you know, like, if I stretch myself too thin, like, I won't be able to do that. So shout out to everybody that works with me. It's even people like you, you know, that, like, that give me the platform to, like, even get my voice heard further, you know. So it's not just me, man, you know.
Yeah, it definitely takes a team, especially in this music business, man. There's nobody's doing it by itself. It's a string of the people. Yeah. On everywhere, man. 100%. How is it coming from a small town? You're able to navigate through the industry without any excuses.
That's a great question. Man, that's a crazy question. Man, my mom told me, like, growing up, like, no one in life can stop you from doing what you want except for yourself. And so the only person that's going to, like, if I ever have an excuse, it's because I came up with that excuse. You know, like, I think I even rap about that. Like, if I end up closing one door, like, well, shit, I could probably just open the one right next to it. Like, I'm looking at the doors right there. Like, there's one open, there's one closed. Like, there's probably another way around, or there's another way to get into something. My dad, like, that's something my dad taught me when I was really, really young. He told me that there's always a way out of everything. And so, like, I think I took that mind state. And, like, one of the biggest things, like, growing up in New Braunfels, you gotta ask anybody from New Braunfels, it's like, how the fuck am I gonna get out of here? Because, like, it's like a curse in New Braunfels. You get stuck there. Like, you just get stuck, and then you just become one of those people that's from New Braunfels and never got out. And so I think having the mind state of, like, I gotta find the way out, you know, and just loving hip hop so much, loving music so much, I was like, damn, well, I gotta try it, you know? If I don't try it, who else is gonna try it?
Because you see a lot of artists, and even being, you know, in San Antonio, a lot of them, and across the world in general, they'll use their city as an excuse of why they're not making it out. You know what I mean? The city itself. But you, on the other hand, is like, no, like, it's not my city. I got to do footwork myself, man.
For sure. For sure. Yeah, man, the world's so big, bro. It's like, I can't blame my city, man. Like, I would come from a small-ass, racist-ass city, bro. Like, if I had that mindset, I probably would have never started rapping, you know, so.
And now, for all the artists coming out there, you know, watching you, the importance of expanding outside of your own city, mm-hmm. you know, like, just go ahead and give them some game on that.
Do it, man. The world is so big, bro. The world is huge. The first people that started rapping with me weren't even from Texas. Shout out, I think we were talking about before the camera was on, one of my favorite, like, I wouldn't call them co-workers, but, like, one of my favorite peers to rap with, his name is, him and his best friend, Joey Freco and Yost. They're from Phoenix, Arizona. We made records together before I ever shook their hand, like, in real life.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, bro, and, like, fire-ass records, like, because we were working with the same kind of producers, so we were on the same type of time. And it's really important, man, because, like, Even if you don't have a following, even if they don't have a following, the one or two people that do listen to you and the one or two people that listen to them, those people are going to be connected over the internet. Like, I have homies from New Braunfels that are interacting with people in Phoenix because, like, on some, like, friend, like, online friend type shit, because they just started following, like, we all just started following each other because of the internet, bro. It's really important because, like, if you don't market yourself, man, that's going to be my theme for the day. If I don't do it, no one else is going to do it. So, like, if you don't do it for yourself, like, who else is going to do it, you know? If you want to get out the city, you want to get further out, you got to do it.
All good, man. Now I want to transition to something else. You're a Hispanic artist out there, right? Mm-hmm. Do you feel like being even as a Hispanic rapper, it comes with a bad stigma. Do you feel that way?
I try not to think about it. I think sometimes it's like, before I rap or someone sees me, I don't ever introduce myself as a rapper. I'll say that first. But I feel like as soon as I do tell someone I rap, they automatically assume I rap like, and no offense whatsoever, but like old Chicano lowrider style sounding rap, which is cool. I fuck with that type of shit too, you know? But like, I definitely think there is a stigma, but I'm not, I'm proud to be Hispanic, but I'm not putting myself out there as like a Hispanic rapper. I'm not no Mexican rapper. I'm just a rapper, bro. Like, you know, cause like, I don't look at, that's kind of fucked up, cause I do be looking at white rappers like white rappers, Asian rappers like Asian rappers, but like, you know, like, my black homies are rappers. I don't look at them like black rappers. And I don't think they look at me like, oh, that's a Mexican rapper. That's a Mexican boy. Like, they say, like, that's Manco. Like, that's, you know, like.
Right.
So, and I fully, like, I was telling someone the other day, like, hip-hop is a black sport 100%. And saying it needs to be respected as such. And so, I go anytime I'm in the studio, anytime I'm promoting anything, anytime I'm, you know, like, I have that mentality. So, I try and have that respect to hip-hop and to my people, to black people, as much as I can, because it's like, I can have that stigma, but let me just show you I can rap. Like, I promise I can rap good, you know?
That's a good, because, and that's a good thing you say, because a lot of the past, you know, Hispanic rappers that came, I guess a lot of them didn't have that craft for people to take them seriously, you know what I mean? The lyrics weren't the best, mm-hmm. So you nailed it. You feel like, you know, Hispanic artists, y'all have more to prove, though? Y'all have to try harder to get y'all's foot in the door?
Man, you ever seen the Selena movie? So that exact quote that her dad tells her, where he's like, Mexican-Americans, and it's not just Mexicans, because Mexicans, I feel like, have a lot more to prove, but, like, Mexican-Americans, like, I have to prove to Mexican people that I'm brown enough to be brown, and I got to prove to American people I got to be American, and I'm American enough, but then also, I don't feel like I gotta prove anything, but I do like having that respect afterwards. Like when I do a show and then I get off stage and it's like, oh, okay, he could rap, you know, like they play my record or something. It's like, oh yeah, that's it. You know? So like sometimes I think there is a little more to prove, but I don't think as an artist, I don't think you should approach the game like that. You know, just make good music, bro. Like that's where I see it.
Man, you said some good stuff right there. Man, that's good. Let's talk about you linking up with Less and just, you know, that whole squad over there. Mm-hmm. You know, how did that happen?
Man, Less found me. I dropped my first ever music video, Keep It P. And he found me within like 7-8 hours of dropping the video. And so I had gone to sleep for the night, man. And I was chilling to my girl at the time at her crib. And I crashed out on the couch and my phone was going off right next to her and shit. She throws my phone at me all pissed off, thinking some hoes, you know, and like whatever, right? I check my phone, it's blown up, like hella notifications, whatever, right? And I find out why it's blowing up, and it's because Les found my shit. And whatever, that we linked up, like, not, well, like internet linked up, you know, and just talked over some DMs real quick, whatever. And ever since then, I just started going down to Houston and building that relationship with them, like on a homie type level, because like I've been listening to Les before that for years, bro. So like the fact that he even recognized me and was like crazy to me. So like I was going out there just to kick it. And then the store manager, G, he's like one of my best friends, bro. He just started bringing me around more. And that's what he would tell me. He was like, just come around. And I'll be like, man, I live all the way out here. And he'd be like, it's probably in your best interest to just come around. And like, at the time, I didn't really get that, you know. But like, the more I come around, the more, like, it was more so like, I wasn't even there on some business shit. Like, I was just there because it's just family, you know. And that's how it is to this day. Like, we're just family. But then it just so happens that, oh, there's an event for this weekend, or there's this going on this weekend, and it just builds those business relationships even more. So, you know, being around Les, being around Georgie, being around Dios and shit, like, changed my life for sure. That's my family, bro. Like, I don't have no family in Houston, so like those are my peoples.
Man, shout out to Houston, man.
I love Houston, bro. Forever in their debt.
Shout out to Houston, man. Do you have a hard time separating your music from the trap wave that's out? Because, you know, like, I feel like your lane of music is kind of you know, people kind of close the door on it. They're not labels, but just, you know, fans in general.
For sure. The labels, too. Shit. Heavy. I think the only person I can think of that signed right now, like, that makes the same sound as me is kind of like Larry. I don't even know if he signed anymore, but he had a little thing going on with Empire, you know, and Jay Worthy, maybe, is signed. But mostly, and I think it's something cool, like, to stand on to say, like, it's all independent. But that's a good question because, like, with this next project, I was in the studio the other day and I was like, damn, like, should I try and make music to appeal to, like, the popular audience, you know? Because I can. Like, making music is easy to me. Like, I could do it. But it's like, do I want to do it because I want to do it, or am I going to do it because I feel like it's going to help me blow, you know? And then if, like, say I blow up off of making music like that I don't even like making, there's no point in even making music if I'm not having fun with it, you know? So I got some crazy sounding records like that, bro, but I don't know if I'm ever gonna put them out.
Would you view that as kind of like basically selling out, you know what I mean? Because you're losing your core value of your, you know, what you originally stand for.
Nah, man. One of my first jobs when I was young, I wrecked a car. Right, I worked at a body shop. I wrecked a car, and I remember my boss, the guy that owned it, he told me something that's gonna stick with me forever. He was like, "Look, I'm not mad, but I need you to remember something." I was like, "What's up?" He's like, "I'm in business to make money, not spend it." And I was like, "All right." So like, nah, I don't think that's selling out. Like, why else are you gonna make music? Like, you know. So like, going back to what I just said, like, I could do it to make money, you know, but like, would I be having fun with it? Probably not as much fun as I have doing it now, because I don't think it's selling out, but I'd probably be having to put up a persona that's not me, or I'd be having to act a certain way to like portray that rapper, you know? So I don't think it's selling out though, because at the end of the day, rap's a business, you know? And so it's like, are you in this to make money? Or are you just in this to like bullshit, you know? So, and I just figured out a way to like, if I can make money making the music I like, I'm going to do that. But, you know.
Damn, you dropped a lot of gems. right now, I appreciate man. It. So, a year from now, man, where are we going to see Banco at, you know?
A year from now?
A year from now,
man. Hopefully here again. Hopefully we can do this next year.
Well, of course.
Man, I don't know. Because I asked myself that last year, and, like, I've been everywhere since then. I feel like. And that's not even like the tip of the iceberg. I was at Les's crib the other day, and we were just talking about my year last year, and I was just tripping, you know, like, damn, we did this, we did that. And he was kind of like, he was all rolling up, and he's just like, just, you know, kind of gave me a little laugh. I was like, what's up? And he's like, bro, you haven't even got started yet. And so I don't know. I don't want to, not that I don't want to manifest nothing, but I don't want to cap myself either. So hopefully everywhere. Hope you see me everywhere next year.
Any shows lined up? I don't see you performing a lot.
Yeah, very selective about performing. So I don't know. We got something. I think Dio's got something going on soon. I'll drop more details about that whenever I get them. But
and one last question. That's good that you brought that up. Why are you selective and where you perform at?
I don't think it's about the location or like where I perform. I think it's more so about, this might sound, and I don't mean this to sound arrogant or cocky in any way, but like, I need to get paid, because like, I got people that are coming with me that I need to pay to be there, you know? Cause like, I can't just show up at this event or whatever that could possibly be making those people money as well. And then I just feel like a circus monkey, you know, like I would pull up and rap and then dip, like, you know, so I don't know, like I'm going to have my camera guy with me. So I'm going to need to pay my camera guy. I might have my dog with me just on some, you know, right behind me type shit. I'm going to need to take care of my dog. I pay for everybody's food that night. I pay for everybody's drinks that night. Like, I make sure everybody's good that day, you know, like I'm going to need. It's not just about me getting paid. Like, when I ask for some bread, like, it's about me and my people. So I'm very selective about it. I would love to do like certain shows, but yeah, I get really offended when people ask me to be on their shows and then they ask me to pay to be on the show, like some pay to play shit. It's like, bro, You come in my DMs asking me to not only perform, but to pay you? So, like, I don't know. I'm very selective about that type of shit, man. Very.
Well, look, man, Banco, again, it was an honor.
Thank you.
To have you. You know, you was part of the show last year.
Yeah.
We did a Loud City. Appreciate you pulling up.
Yeah, appreciate you having me, man.
You rock the crowd. And,
yeah, yeah.
And I, you know what? It feels good to see what you're doing, man. I'm seeing you, you know what I'm saying, like, everything's increasing for you, man.
Thank you.
So, man, just want to tell you, keep doing what you're doing. You know, views, you need anything, we got your support 100%, man.
Oh, bro, thank you. I appreciate that a lot.
Well, look, man, this is Views Media Group, man. Mr. Cole Mal Ave in the building. Y'all be on the lookout.
Say that.